Hello and welcome to the program. I am DEJI Badimasi. Let's begin the conversation this week with an important issue bordering on accountability in agencies of government. Quite all right, budgets are passed and allocations are made, and different ministries get revenue generation targets as to how much to remit, of course, to the Federation account yearly. And that is just where it ends, as we usually don't follow up and talk about implementation, monitoring, and performance as well. Now, the Auditor General of the Federation recently released the 2017 audit report, revealing how government ministries, departments, and agencies violate fiscal and audit rules. The 2017 audit report showed that majority of the revenue-generating agencies of government and other MDAs did not remit withholding taxes, value-added taxes, stamp duty, capital gains tax, as well as pay-as-you-earn tax, among others. There are also reports that 160 agencies failed to submit their audited accounts now for 2016. 265 agencies defaulted in the submission of their audited accounts for 2017, while 11 have never submitted any financial statements since inception. Now, we don't know what the figure would be for 2018 and 2019, but this is really bad. Now, in addition to all of that, anti-corruption group, the Center for Social Justice, has been noting some irregularities in the 2017 Federation account transcript statement. The director of Center for Social Justice now, Eze Onyekwere, joins me on the program from Abuja. Thank you very much, Mr. Onyekwere, for joining us on the program. Now, this audit report is mind-blowing. Before we begin to talk about your own findings, I mean, you have seen the audit report. It's shocking. Tell me what you make of it.
It's a litany of fiscal woes in terms of not adhering to the sound principles of public finance management. And the unfortunate part of it is that year after year, the Auditor General reports the same set of fiscal misdemeanors and fiscal felonies, and no follow-up is done in terms of correcting those anomalies. So what Agency A did last year, and the Auditor General wrote a report saying it is wrong, the same agency will repeat it in the next year, and certainly nothing will happen. If you look at the progression, instead of making progress, we are moving back. Like 2016,
165.
About 165 agencies did not report.
And then 2017, 265.
200 and something. So you have an addition of over 100. So it's a situation of impunity. Yes, we did it last year. You did nothing. We'll still do it again. You will not do anything. So it's a litany of woes.
And what is even more shocking is that, look, these are government agencies and departments. I mean, even revenue-generating agencies as well. And we have situations where some have never, never submitted any audited report at all.
Yeah, that's the unfortunate part of it. And apparently there's no sanction, because apart from the constitution, which merely provided for the Office of the Auditor General, his report to PAC saying he should be independent, providing for his remuneration and appointment procedure, there is nothing governing audit, because the 1956 audit ordinance is no longer part of the laws of the Federation. It was not reproduced in the laws of the Federation 1990, neither was it reproduced in the laws of the Federation 2004. So as we speak today, we don't have a functional audit law. And all attempts by the legislature since the return to civil rule have made to pass the audit bill 3 times, it was turned down. The President Obasanjo did not sign it into law. Goodluck Jonathan, the same thing. And now Muhammadu Buhari. And that's very sad, considering that President Muhammadu Buhari has made the anti-corruption fight a very big part of the cornerstone of his administration.
The question I want to ask you is, what corruption could be worse than this? Because if agencies, departments of government, are not, for instance, remitting withholding tax, they're not remitting pay-as-you-earn tax, then where has the money? Where does the money go to?
Yeah, that's not even, it is beyond corruption. This is economic sabotage. Because when you collect withholding tax, when you collect taxes, they are not part of your revenue. They are not money you made. It is money you are collecting on behalf of either the Federation or the federal government. So automatically, it should be swept into the TSA or whatever special accounts where it should go to. So this is just direct and stealing from the public. So it's economic sabotage. It's something that should be deprecated. And those responsible should be brought to book.
And of course, I mean, your organization has gone through the 2017 audit report. Tell us about some of your findings.
Well, a good part of the findings borders on a company like an MPC acting outside the crucibles of Section 162 of the Constitution. They dig up crude oil with the joint venture partners, sell it, then deduct whatever they consider their cost. No third party is looking at it or anything. And then remit less than 50% of all they made to the Federation account. And year after year, the Auditor General for the Federation has said, this is wrong. You cannot continue doing this. Remit the whole money to the Federation account, then bring your claims for whatever expenditure you have done to be able to generate that revenue. And then you still have a situation where funds like the Ecological Fund, which is specifically designed to fund the remediation of ecological challenges, federal government dips hand into it and purportedly lends money to Kano State, lends money to Osun State. So this is ridiculous. And so many other funds like that, that money is being taken away outside of the mandate for which they were established by law and being used for clearly illegal purposes. You also have situations where so many MDAs you may not even expect, like the educational institutions, the universities and polytechnics, the revenue due to the federal government from them running into billions of naira were not remitted. So, like I did mention before, it's a litany of woes. You go to the Federal Radio Corporation in Ibadan, you see a whole lot of scandal of monies that are due to be remitted to the federal government not being remitted. You go to Security and Exchange Commission, you see a director general collecting allowance upon allowance, car allowances that are running to almost 100 million. You begin to ask yourself, what manner of car is this person entitled to? You collect your severance allowance, they bring you back, you still continue to collect another one. So there's so much that you cannot, if it's running to 590 something pages, each of the pages is just calculating what makes the heart grow cold. And also on top of that, the Auditor General for the Federation has been crying year after year that his office is poorly funded. You have a situation where auditees, those who are expected to first audit, are the ones determining the funding of the audit office. So the office of the Auditor General is underfunded. Even the little money that is promised in appropriation never gets released. They don't enjoy a first-line charge. So the Auditor General doesn't even have enough funds and human resources to be able to go around the ministries, departments, and agencies to look into the accounts. So what he does is a sample. Yes, I admit he cannot go around all of them. He's bound to do a sample. But what is the strength of the sample if he doesn't have enough resources to do the work for which he's paid to do? So we have a situation where there are institutional challenges, infrastructure challenges, funding challenges, and then legal challenges in terms of the lack of a functional law, the lack of a law to guide audit work in Nigeria. So
let's quickly talk about that law now. It's so shocking. You look at the amount of money the country is losing through plain corruption, because this is just plain corruption. There's just no word for it. Yet we keep dilly-dallying, if you like, over the audit bill. Up till this moment, that bill is not in place. I mean, the bill has not been passed. President Buhari basically refused to give his assent to the bill in the 8th Assembly. Why do you think, not just this government, even the previous government, you know, found it very difficult to give its assent to the bill? I'm talking about previous presidents now, including this president.
Because successive administrations have always had something to hide. They pretend to be fighting corruption when in actual fact they are promoting corruption. Because there's no way you can pretend to be fighting corruption without properly institutionalizing the work of the Auditor General. You institutionalize it through a legal regime as well as adequate funding and remuneration of the key personnel so that they can do their work. So the powers that be know that if this office is properly empowered, it will stop a lot of the things that they're doing. For instance, Auditor General, if properly empowered, can stop the shenanigans that NMPC and their cohorts are doing. If properly empowered, they can even stop allocations to some of these MDAs that are withholding money and not releasing it. If properly empowered, it can say the accounting officer, the minister or the permanent secretary, should not collect their salaries until they obey the recommendations, come clean. with the recommendations that are made. If their action or inaction leads to a loss to the Treasury, they will be bound to make good the loss before they proceed to do any other thing. Otherwise, their emoluments could be withheld. So they don't want to be accountable. Those who should advise the president advise him otherwise. Even the president himself does not have the presence of mind to be able to do the right thing by signing the bill into law. And this is the first bill we are witnessing. The president neither signed the bill into law nor sent back a letter to the National Assembly to say, these are my reasons for not signing. Because he knows that if he says anything to that effect, Nigerians will see through the deceit of saying that corruption is being fought when it is not being fought. Mr. President should tell Nigerians why he didn't sign the bill and at the same time refuse to send a reason, you know, for not signing to the National Assembly. It's shameful.
It's actually shameful. And, you know, one begins to get the impression that our fight against corruption, it's just almost nothing at all if we're not dealing with this.
Yeah, definitely. That's why I say that it's deceitful to say they are fighting corruption when they don't believe in it. Because beyond, you see, the EFCC is a creature of statute. ICPC is a creature of statute. But this is a constitutional office created by the grand norm. And it should enjoy preeminence. You get to the budget of EFCC, ICPC, their budget is more than two or three times the budget of the Auditor General. Ordinary law created this, and a law which is inferior to the Constitution. So why should the Auditor General's office not enjoy the preeminent role? And the Auditor General's office is not amenable to politicization because you have all kinds of professionals. They come to your office, say, produce your books. You look at your books, prepare your accounts, you produce them. They look at the books and say, no, we think A, B, C, D is wrong. They give you the opportunity to come and talk to them and respond with your own side of the story. It's after you have responded, they go back again and look at it to say, this is right or wrong, that they now write their report. Even after writing their report, you still have the opportunity to go to the Public Accounts Committee in the National Assembly, in both the Senate and the House, to clear your name. So there is a process. There's an institution. It's not just the wish or whim or caprice of one person who just profess a charge to spoil somebody's name, whether you are guilty or not guilty. At the end of the day, the court frees you, but your name has already been rubbished. They have chartered accountants, they have engineers, they have lawyers, they have forensic experts. It's a complete institution that should be supported. Why government is not supporting it? Why government is not promoting it? The answer is best known to them.
Honestly, it beats my imagination to think that, you know, in 2016, 165 defaulted, 2017, about 200 and something. If nothing is done and we continued along this line, then the time will come when none of government agencies now will make any remission at all. I mean, they'll basically not submit any audit report at all, and nothing happens.
Nobody is asking them. Yeah, nobody's asking them, why are they not doing this? They should stop it.
It's a shame, to be candid. It's actually a shame. Thank you very much, Ezeonyoshkore, for your time, and thank you very much for talking to us.
Thank you. My pleasure.
All right, we'll take a short break, and we'll be right back to still continue the discussion on issues centered on anti-corruption. Stay with us. On DEJI 360, we don't just ask the questions. What is wrong with amending the Constitution the way the National Assembly members have been doing it? We seek answers.
Constitution is constituent. Our problem is not lack of laws. Our problem is lack of the willpower to implement our laws.
Answers that provide clarity.
While we negotiate, we should try to make it a point that the girls must be complete.
The clarity you need to make informed judgment so that you can make the right decision and take action. People are saying it is you politicians that are responsible for this, that you are the reason why this is happening.
All these dullards that call themselves governors in this country?
I wish we had people like Tony at the National Assembly.
God forbid that I go to join that
DEJI 360, providing clarity to issues.